Perfect. Well, thanks for coming. I've written a book. Not a published author. And I'm just going to go through quite quickly and talk about some of what we're doing in your office and how I think we can improve it. I am not a marketer, so my ideas are dubious of value in some way. But one of the things I think we need more of is investment. There are plenty of things in your office. There are lots of good ideas. And we need to make sure we can fund these and, you know, attack new markets, fix new features, improve things everywhere. And the question is, ultimately, how to get investment. And I think before we look at that, it's probably useful to think how we currently build a LibreOffice and how that actually happens. So here's a pretty picture. It has numbers on it. I'm sorry. The picture is to try and make the numbers more interesting. But currently, we have something like 600,000 euros of donations, mostly around 10 euros, none of them very large. Coming in from consumers, I would argue, these are individuals downloading it, and that's wonderful. That allows us to run TDF. Of course, there's some advisory board fees that go into that too, but they're relatively small. And I would argue we have approximately zero donations from enterprises. Enterprises tend to contribute, if at all, via providing long-term support, doing consultancy, getting some kind of services that goes to our corporate contributor ecosystem, so companies like Collaborative, Minagora, obviously Red Hat, and others. And then these then contribute back to the code. So this is the picture of code. LibreOffice is much more than code, but looking at code is something we can reasonably easily measure. But I think if we have no code, it's hard to market something or translate it or whatever. So there's some kind of, you know, like, we need to improve this and then we can improve the other things too. In addition to contributing something like 70%, more than 70% of code commits, also if you look at the reviewed by tags for non-self-reviews, you find out that more than half of them are also done by corporations. So there's really quite a significant impact there. Our companies also continue to invest in the ecosystem, although, you know, it's a relatively small inflow. And some of them are making losses, which you can also consider as an investment. So that's great. And against that, of course, is some degree of profit taking. Companies like to make profits. Any questions? Do haggle or heckle or, you know, something if you have a problem. So there are some alternatives that we could structure our ecosystem in different ways. I'm going to sort of rush over these. Here's one that's sort of, I guess, Mozilla as a business probably does this. Joining the brand and the sort of consulting or development enterprise. I think this is generally a sort of a centrally planned way to manage things, and it doesn't hit every price point. There are people who have a passion for serving charities of open source and need to earn a small amount of money from them. Other people have a passion for Angoran language translation and want to build a business there. And these are all things that are very hard for a single company to do with a single price point, a single cost structure, or whatever. So I would argue that TDF doing everything is going to lead to a centrally planned disaster area that doesn't serve all of these interesting niches that a diverse ecosystem can potentially serve. So I'm not a fan of this, but it's certainly an option. And if you assume that people would continue to do this and so on, then this might work. I think the problem is that the existing professional service companies would effectively collapse into TDF simply because having one customer is not great business model. And in consequence, it's very unlikely that people invest significantly because there is clearly no future to that as a separate ecosystem. So I think you'll just see a loss there. And so it's possible we could restructure ourselves like this and turn into a centrally planned TDF as a business model. I didn't like TDF as a business model, but it's certainly an option. Another thing is that we could just go down the extreme, but these are some extremes. Another extreme is the free as in beer path, where everything is free forever and for always, and we then continue to get nothing from TDF, pretty much, from enterprises. Presumably the consumers are happy to get software and continue to donate. Perhaps there's still some consultancy that goes into here. But then again, it's very hard to sell a product against everything is free and forever. There has to be some degree of scarcity that someone will pay for. So if TDF provides everything, long-term support, consultancy, migration training, whatever it happens to be, it's very hard to build a business. And so I think this would potentially harm our
it's quite significant. Unless we very substantially grew this number, there's actually far less money than it is, because it's just a sort of, we're missing €1 million here, so, versus the previous numbers, simply because business is a greater free riding. If they can avoid paying, they certainly will not. And we see that in many ways. So that's a very different business.
So some people suggest that we should, as TDF, produce a shared long-term supported version. We should do a more free, as in beer, version. And we should provide that for everyone on a free of charge. And this will hugely increase the amount of uptake of our software, and in the end, profit. So I think this is the approach that Canonical has taken with Ubuntu. And we see the end of that, which is decimating the Linux desktop ecosystem in terms of other companies, and ultimately failing and firing on desktop team. So I'm not particularly thrilled by that approach. I think it's a proven as a failure. But also, there's some engineering problems here. If we want to long-term support all of these releases, we have a formidable engineering problem of doing that. And that's something that's really hard to do, particularly because companies today do this. And actually, there's a huge amount of work there funded by enterprises that do it. Of course, you can reduce the number of releases that you support, say it's engineering. But actually, you'll notice that Ubuntu was eager here to not ship the version Red Hat was shipping and share engineering costs, but to ship something slightly newer in their release. And so they ended up being the only people that supported Ubuntu. So a lot of extra work and so on supporting this branch. And so it seems that people really want to ship the latest thing on their timeline, and that sort of overrides any concern you're going to support it for 2 years or 4 years or whatever on your own. So there's no free lunch there. I think the other thing about TDF providing an LTS version is that many of the staff working in these distributions, of whom there are now many fewer, a part of justifying their role inside the organization is to say, we do this thing. We provide the support, we backport patches, we do the security fixing. And if another organization outside says, we do all that, suddenly you have even less investment in your ecosystem, because it's even easier for distros to free ride as well. So while Mozilla do that, they have $500 million a year cash account from search. The other thing to say about TDF doing an LTS version is that this is really a corporate problem, not a consumer problem. And it's unclear why all of our home users donating €10, which we're very grateful for, should be subsidizing companies, avoiding the ability to, avoiding the need to invest in SaaS. So why should that? So I'd just like to look at how our ecosystem currently works and the several different business models in that, how that's shaped. So consultancy is, or professional services, the most obvious contribution, I suppose, here. It's very clear. A person has a need, and they get it fixed. And they've deployed LibreOffice, it doesn't do what they want, and they want something amended. This does happen. So typically, the idea is they deploy LibreOffice, they find they have a problem, they find the budget for it sometime later, 3 to 9 months, budgets are yearly often. Then they tender, sometimes they tender twice. There's a framework tender, and then a year later there's another tender for the actual task. And then eventually they sign the contract, hopefully with one of the vendors. The vendors all compete with each other, so the price is significantly lower. So in terms of the money that's invested. So you as a buyer want the money to be lower. I completely understand that. We as a community want as much money coming into our ecosystem as possible. So in fact, if we had a world where everybody tendered, maybe it would be 50% less money would come into our ecosystem. We have to tender, as TDF we have to. But I just point out that it cuts the work. So then you do the work, which is often quite quick. The prepayment for it often arrives after the work is done. There's then sometimes a 3-month validation phase. Meanwhile, LibreOffice is releasing this thing. And then there's a final payment, and eventually they deploy the stable release. This process is not only horribly inefficient, extremely risky, makes many people estimate the same work, reduces the amount of stuff that comes in, but it's also very, very risky. The first thing to say is that consultancy businesses are not things people invest money in significantly. If you go to a venture capitalist and say, I want to start a new consultancy business, they will simply laugh at you in a quite aggressive way. They want to see a product, they want to see a service product, maybe tight lift is a, but if they want to see a long-term scalable revenue stream out of your consultancy, not seen as a scalable revenue stream.
Yeah, I wouldn't say that was accurate. I think they would invest in a consultancy, but typically the amount they'll loan you is insufficient for you to start the business, because the return they expect on the investment is about two times the valuation at the point of investment.
Okay.
And but I have taken a company to VCs and asked for investment, and their main point is that without an intellectual property asset to lock the customers in, they won't loan you enough money to start the business.
I think we're broadly saying something.
We are saying the same thing. They would invest in something with a consulting model if they could, like for example Tidelift, if it is presented to them in a way that indicates that they're able to start the business on the low investment that's possible given the valuation.
Sure. So it's all a money thing, but so it's a good thing to say is that I think partly this ties into it, the margins of consultancy are typically reasonably low. Gross margins, you know, professional services maturity benchmark from Kimball's is gross margins on consultancy are 20% in our business, 90%. Which makes, and 20% is no problem if you're a product business like Intel and you can make it up on volume. Like you make so many processes, you know, this is a big upside. But yeah, if you have to hire new people and take that risk, it's a problem. Timelines tend to burn people out. Overruns are very frequent because of the low margin and hard problem estimating the length it takes to do anything. You have to pipeline stuff very aggressively, so you have loads of contracts in the pipeline at once to try and hide this latency, and that results in a very cyclical business. And if you win lots, you have feast, and if you don't win lots, you have famine. It's very hard. And staffing, you know, trying to keep people going and keeping them motivated, it's bad. And as you grow a consultancy, it's like driving a lorry faster in the fog. You still don't see any further ahead just because you're driving faster. So consultancy, you know, it's a great business model. We do half our business on that, but it's hard to scale. The other piece that you miss here is the file the bug upstream and hope someone fixes it for you freeze, which is another phase that can last quite some time. So that's one model. I think the ideal model of every consultant's dream is that 10 people order the same product at a fixed cost, and you can finally make a margin. Okay? And actually, when you build a product, this almost happens. So you have lots of partners, customers, and whatever, want the same feature implemented. And you can implement it for them once, and you can tell them all that it's done for them, which is true. But you know, this really helps. And you can aggregate lots of smaller bits of money together in a simple way to actually be able to do bigger things. So that's what we do. And of course, from an SLA perspective, you know, if you've got a bit of support, you can deploy this thing and get patches back. And you can close this loop very quickly because you have your own version that just works. So within 1 week, in the best case, you can have a fixed loop profits. Within a month or a hard bug, you can have one, two. So anyway, that's just some idea of some of the models there. I guess there's another proprietary extension model that's probably quite interesting. But this is basically teaching people to suck eggs. Who has a bank account? Yeah. You getting any interest on that? Probably not, right? So you think, I'll put my money somewhere else, right? I will invest it in something. And you can invest it in horses. If you get out to the racetrack, you can get great returns, you know, like there's 57 times a return. But the reason of that is it's not going to win, of course, and you will lose everything. Or you can put it in a house. Most people, when they invest their hard-earned savings for a lifetime, what they're primarily interested in is not so much the return that comes back, but getting their original capital back. Okay? So, you know, you smash your piggy bank. In the LibreOffice world, you smash your piggy bank. You invest it in LibreOffice like this. This is the easy bit, writing the checks is fun, and then all sorts of good things are done. But we need to make sure that what happens is not this one. If you get a smaller return, meaning that you lose your money, which is, you know, then are you going to continue to invest in this thing? I think the answer is no. And so nothing happens. Of course, if you get a larger return, even maybe marginally larger, if you're an idealist, but at least getting your capital back, you will like you to reinvest, which is good. This money then effectively comes around the system again. If you get a significantly larger return, what you discover is that this is a significantly larger investment. So in fact, by getting a return, you can crowd more money in. It's obvious. I hate to
say the obvious things, but sometimes they're things that are not said. So, what I think TDM is interested in is getting more investment and getting more and more diverse vendors investing into this. So, how is it, having put something into LibreOffice, you can get a return? Say we go away and we put 100,000 euros into writing some cool new feature for LibreOffice. How do we get a return on that? How does the company get a return that put that in, right? How can we even correlate those things together? So here's my thing on product marketing. So marketing is hard, but at the end of the day, what you want are leads. These leads, some customer that might buy something. Of course, not every lead actually buys anything. That's sales' problem, right? They have to go and love them and count their children and go to the bar mitzvah and all of this stuff, and then eventually they close something that can be reinvested. But there are lots of ways of marketing. Obvious ways are web advertising, €2 a click, something like that, for your advert here, right? And these things, they basically don't work. So we've put quite a lot of money into this whole, and it doesn't result in leads that we can close. At least certainly not in proportion to, it does result in leads, but not enough to pay the cost per click. Now, of course, TDF gets free money from Google to do it, and that's great. And this is an effective way to get people to download a free thing.
Yeah,
We shouldn't give paws in the mouth. Right?
Actually, looking at what making a better analysis, they click on it. I think that downloads are negligible in comparison with clicks on that.
Right.
It's more a branding exercise than download, because it's really, if you look at the conversion, it's less than 1%. So it's not really helping our downloads.
Yeah.
So one of the things that I'm thinking, is to change the page where they're going, mm-hmm. to see if changing that brings something different. So yeah. Donations or any involvement or any other activity.
Yeah. So I mean, less than 1% for the €2 a click, and then you tweak it so your things are cheaper. But if you want to really advertise, something.
Yeah, like, absolutely.
But because you're interested in just visibility. But the thing is, they 1% of these, you're getting €0.02 back at like 1%. Actually, download the free version, and that's before they pay.
You know how much Microsoft bids on the Word Office?
Yeah.
$25.
Right.
And so there's no space for anyone else.
We're particularly affected by the fact that our account only allows us to make a maximum bid.
Yeah.
So we all of our bids are under €2 per click.
No.
They're way below because we're capped there. So we're not interfering with your. Advertise, you get the clicks first.
Yeah, we could advertise. We spent, I think, how much? We spent £10,000-£15,000 on this, and we looked at our investment and we tweaked it, we optimized it, and Kenny spent. But the reality was, this is not a great way to advertise. The other thing you can do is you can go to conferences, and they cost around €5,000 minimum to go to conferences in terms of sponsorship. Conference, so you actually get a booth, travel to there, and so on. If you're a sort of pseudo open source project, Nextcloud, OwnCloud, Hadoop, and you're really a sort of corporately owned and controlled project, often you get a free booth and a free grant, like TDF does. But in a vendor neutral non-profit like LibreOffice, Collaborate certainly doesn't get a free booth. So there's some piggybacking you can do. But I've been to conferences packed with governments, open source, well-meaning people, compared by Simon Fitz. Simon has generously said, look, Collabora sponsored the conference, you could do a lot worse than buying sponsors, just unsolicited and much appreciated steers to the conference, 150 people in it, which, are the right people, still the number one, right? So this cost is far too expensive to replicate, scale, and major return. So you don't get leads there. Or you have to pick your conferences extremely carefully. So, other things you can do, you can have your brand. So like organic search is a big part of our business. Our brand is, people are aware of our brand now, Collabora Office, Collabora Online. I don't know why, but they search for it, and they find us, and so we get some degree of that. That's often driven by news. So a large portion of our leads come from news items that are about the cool new things that we've done in our product, and so on. And possibly, another huge thing is linking. If we can attach ourselves to another project, say LibreOffice, for which we do some work, then it's reasonably cheap to get leads
from that, people who are interested, and so on. So that's my quick take on product marketing. And, I don't know if it seems realistic, but if it's reasonably helpful. So here's another kind of problem. Framing is really important. And how you present your product is important. This is a particularly pathological example, though. We are the Linux desktop is Ubuntu. And if you run Ubuntu, I was at SUSE, so I saw a different side of the isn't it all wonderful and free and free and forever group club. You know, the logo is a group club, isn't that great? No cost at all. Nothing. LTS support is free forever. We will always be there for you. But the reality is, whilst the marketing message is extremely powerful and results in a very large usage of Ubuntu, the actual work on the Linux desktop was primarily doing by Red Hat and also SUSE, to a large degree. I was the Linux desktop architect in this team, and I saw the impact of the entry of this into our market and the de-resourcing of things. Now, of course, Red Hat could have invested much less in the desktop and much more in marketing, which is good for marketers. And we could have de-invested. If all the investment, you have to choose what to invest. Is it marketing or is it technology? As the project, LibreOffice, what we want is lots of investment in the technology, not lots of competing marketing messages. I would argue. Maybe there are different views. But this is certainly a pathology that's particularly bad. One way around it is this brand sharing model whereby, OpenOffice, everybody comes to OpenOffice. Nextcloud or own cloud, but it's really a corporate thing. So there is a buy button. You go to the Capano website, and it's a community website, and it's very thin. Everywhere you go, there is a buy, there is a pricing, there is a get support, there's all these vectors that steam. I don't think that's appropriate for LibreOffice, obviously, but it explains why other open source projects perhaps have an easier ride. There is a company that owns that, or that brand. So here's an example of just something that is quite interesting. So this is sort of commercial branding. So Collaborate Online is something we put a lot of effort into. We use Code, obviously, as our consumer brand. We get news and search and things from that. We get leads from that. That allows us to sell something, and so we put Code back into LibreOffice, which is great. Everything will be open. If instead we have a massive marketing drive on LibreOffice Online, then we have whole load of interest there, we drive people to this page instead, we tell them about LibreOffice, we build that brand. They all head to Document Foundation, and at which point, almost none of them discover a collaborator. Which, since our investment here is proportional to the lead flow, however large it is, potentially, instead of being 100%, it's a fraction of a percent. That can potentially kill the product. And so I'm really grateful that, in large part, TDF marketing is quite restrained about how that goes on. Where's that 0.05% come from? Well, this comes from the Matomo figures here. So professional support page here has something like 12,500 links. When you look at the bounce rate and you add it all in, versus the 9 million unique page views for the download page, which is one of our top pages, not the top page. And donated courses when it comes through. So you see that 9 million in terms of 6 million shows you not everyone clicks down that, right? But basically, no one comes to the professional support page, which is a shame because our whole ecosystem, businesses, their certification, certified migrators and trainers and people, their business is being seen. And if you are a small individual certified trainer, getting visibility is hard. I mean, it's hard for collaborators to get leads with a big team of 20 people and blah, 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 all this stuff, right? But if you're an individual and you want to build a business around LibreOffice, we want you to do that. We should be trying to help you and get that proportion of leads up, it seems to me. Just to visualize 0.05%. So this is the Code contribution by Charles Proxmith Companies. Of course, there's mentoring going into half of the volunteer commits. And this is the proportion of people that are coming to LibreOffice then notice the professional services again. So I would argue that we could do better here. And actually, it should be easy to do better, going from 0.05% to 5%, or even 1%, or even 0.5%, is potentially a very large win, and if you can help. So as of today, TDF itself is a very small proportion of leads for Flutter, and it's a shame. What else? So I think, yeah, what we love to talk about. I think
So there's a lot of improvements here, and one of the things I most loved yesterday was Itala talked about our security situation, which is outstanding. I'm always sitting there going, yes, it's all done by Quavo, you know? And I was just thrilled to see you credit Quavo with his Red Hat. This is a Red Hat person. We have a secure product and a much more stable product only because of Red Hat. So there's practically no one else investing in that. And so it's great to say that. I think that's only fair, reasonable to do that. But I think in terms of what we talk about, and we start to talk now more in our press releases about how the hypothesis is developed, which is great. But I think we need to have a much more numerate focus on, you know, what's the relationship between a press release and how that actually ends up driving behaviors we want. I think the other thing is that if we market a product and we say, LibreOffice is awesome, which it is, come and get it, use it, it's great, which it is, we don't necessarily prepare people for the it's a camel problem, right? There is a real camel issue here. And so when they come back and go, my camel, I have to beat it to go 50 yards and something else, and in these cases it doesn't do what I want, there can be some upset there. And people write, why is it not working? But they expect support. We get these things saying, I've donated, why are you supporting? And I've got some things in the paper which I'll publish soon. You know, my company uses the latest, I think, version of LibreOffice, and we have a problem with integrating with this tool. Can you help me? This is a request on the security list where, you know, for free, companies look for fixing our security bugs. Red Hat, you know, reply and say, well, what version have you got? Well, we got 4.2.0.4, which is not really the latest version of LibreOffice. Arguably, these people have not understood their need for getting a supported version, and you know, so it's not actually serving them, and it's not serving us, which is slightly unfortunate. And so I think as we talk about the product, we need to talk about the product, of course, but we also need to talk about the community, because actually this is a problem that is not just for me, it's not just for companies, it's for volunteers as well, it's paid staff. I think crediting individuals for their contribution is something beautiful that we can do and we should do prominently, because we are a product made by people. And even if they pretend to wear purple t-shirts or red t-shirts and be in a company, first of all, they're not different from anyone else. Or they wear green t-shirts and do marketing. You know, there's this great work happening, and I think celebrating individuals and companies, whoever's contributing, is a really important part of what we do. We need to do that more and more effectively, and talk perhaps less, you know, if in a zero-sum game, Move the balance of the scales here to talk more about the community. I think in the marketplace, it's typical in our industry to say, look at this amazing demo, you know, come and buy it, buy a camera. And the subtext there is, of course, that when you bought it, we will use your money to fix it and make it actually do what we told you it would do, you know. So that's the investment cycle, the hype cycle in our industry. The Sagrada Familia model, come and see this awesome cathedral. It's not quite finished, and in paying you make it better. Unfortunately, our marketing can sometimes look like, God, it's an amazing product, it's entirely free. And we'll work out how we can actually fund finishing and polishing and making it secure. That's someone else's problem, you know, later. And I think a more helpful approach is come and look at our amazing, you know, amazing project, our contributors, and get involved in improving this great product. Right? So we're talking, we're leading with project contributors, software, open source. And, you know, the subtext that the community should be fun, and we should talk about that more. As myself, supported LibreOffice, I often meet people who seem to think that it's not authentic. There's actually a problem with buying something that doesn't have LibreOffice on it. I want the real stuff. I want the real LibreOffice. And, unfortunately, TDF are the only people who can fix that and convincing them. It's hard for us to be perceived as being a fake knockoff of the project that we do so much to build. And that's very real. I'm sorry, Torsten's in here to back me up on this. I was talking with him the other day. I think it's a repeated problem. And if we cannot sell, you know, products to people, it's very hard to do that. So we need to overcome, I think, that. I have a whole load of conclusions, which I don't think I've had time particularly to put out. One of them, I think, is pretty clear. I think a whole load of little details that we can use to change things here. One of them is just this bit of text here, which is my best noir. If you deploy LibreOffice in an enterprise or corporate environment for a conservative user, please choose this version. I would argue you need to choose Red Hat, LibreOffice, Sims, LibreOffice from SIB, PowerSIB, or Collaborators. And I think so this potentially is misleading. There's a good thing here about
getting support alongside it. But I think the way LibreOffice is released, its release schedule, its support schedule and so on, is not what enterprise users should be using. They should be using a professional a product from someone that does the boring 5 years of support that we don't care about for consumers. And so how we can then focus this more on the consumers who pay our bills and donate to us, and encourage people to not use it in a way that actually hurts our development investment in the project. So I think Bjorn had some good ideas there about positioning this being system on profits. And I should point out again that we're not suggesting changing anything about the software particularly. In fact, so you should don't get rid of this particularly, or have something different. So you can still come and free ride if you want. You know, if your business is based on this, so be it. But in terms of how it's presented, we want to steer people verbally away from deploying this in governments, in large enterprises, because they should be taking some of that saving and putting it into improving our product, or we simply won't, you know, have a successful ecosystem that grows. I think this is a real problem. But I think this framing, I think Simon is famous for the for pointing out that if you call stuff free software, you're immediately in a lack of price framing. And actually, we all care about software freedom, but there are better ways to say that. LibreOffice, not FreeOffice, right? We have it in our name. But when you hit the website, the first thing you see is free Office Suite, giant banner at the top, download now. And this is well tuned, it works. No, I'm not kidding. There's nothing wrong with it, but I think the framing can potentially be problematic. And all of our calls to action are download now. And I think if we're going to emphasize more on community and growing that, I think potentially starting maybe with fantastic people, you know, just small tweak to randomize this thing.
That should really go to the get involved page, yeah. I've thought about changing this. I'm not sure if it's possible with this. It's
curious.
But yeah, it doesn't make any sense that I've downloaded under that. We need three separate messages, yeah.
Absolutely. And I think which one we present to people, maybe we reduce our downloads slightly, but increase our people involved. To me, that's a brilliant trade, because actually the people who get involved contribute far more than any 10 euro donation, at 1% conversion rate, or, you know, 1.5. I mean, like, the one euro that we get from, you know, losing a person, if we lose from losing a person, we can get 50,000 euros worth of contribution. We could never afford that. Potentially we can grow that community and, you know, more people, more fun, and so on. So then I ran out of time to put all sorts of other actions here. So I think Mike and Natalia have a long list there. But I think really just celebrating corporate investments in what we do is useful. There's a lot of it. We can do that factually. We can find creative ways with Mike to make that possible, I think. But I think we need to, you know, start doing that and making it clear that everyone is a welcome part of the ecosystem and should be celebrated. I think from a strategy perspective, TDF really needs to remove the fear of doing something wrong and accidentally promoting, you know, something you shouldn't, because, you know, whatever. I think we need to get a bit less uptight about that, have clear guidelines and people are happy if you're doing that. And I think we also need to give confidence to people who invest. I think we need to be really upfront about what we're doing. So I think if you look at this picture, the problem is this step here. When you take this step to put your money down and actually invest it, what you need to be sure is that by the time actually anything happens, you actually get the return. Because the returns are not immediate anytime you invest. It's a year later, it's 2 years later. Maybe it's a 5-year horizon of trying to build your product brand, right? It's debilitating if you think the rules can change underneath your feet in a semi-random way, or a way that actually may coerce you to do other things, or is connected to all sorts of other things. It's very, very problematic. So there's a serious risk, obviously, of any kind of investment, but having a well-defined structure is very, very, very helpful on that. So just as an example, if you're investing here in writing smart art, it's nice if actually you get credit for that, really clearly. You know, and that's presented as something that has been done by this party and the volunteers that deal with people, and it's pretty accurate, fair, reasonable. And so then, you know, people see that, hopefully, bring them off the street and find something. So I think that's pretty much my talk. I said there was not much in terms of development or changing roadmaps or you know how we develop stuff. I think there are things that we can do that are peaceful and sensitive and actually have a disproportionate impact. So we've started to do something like pop-ups. This little bar that says, why don't you invest in me? You know, join our fun community, which is showing good results already, I hope. And this is something you're unlikely to see in a commercial product. And so we start to move this to the consumer product, and this to be an enterprise product, so create more room for that bifurcation. So that's good. I think we could do more of that, talking about free software, open source, and how important it is potentially. I think we could change over time how the product looks, so it's more consumer-y. I don't know if that makes sense. But I'm sure Mike has some great ideas of, hey, well, we can make it more minimal thing, we can make it, you know, we can configure the default, so there's always still the enterprise version there, but actually the default looks like a more fun, cut-down UI, experimental, you know, there's all sorts of things we can do. The art style is not consciously boring. It's more like, hey, let's have a, you know, some fun stuff in it. We can bring back Easter eggs. So it's amazing how much the idea of an Easter egg brings out corporate customers in a rash. They think it's some kind of virus that will kill them. But it can just be like a little Tetris game in a spreadsheet, right? They have, you know, 100 lines of Starbase, so they can never kill anyone. But actually, that's something they really, really hate. And potentially, we remove it from the past for our enterprise users. But actually, if we're a fun, consumer-focused product, well, actually, people might like to go and discover you. It's like fun game, stock up game in the spreadsheet and play Tetris. Why not? Right. So,
do you think then if users and enterprise users still aren't aware of professional support, that's something maybe we can bake into the opposite. So we've added things to the help menu, for instance, to get involved in domains. We have an info bar now after 30 days of installation to get involved. Do you think there's some scope for like professional support or just a blue sky idea, a banner that says this is a community supported version.
So it's like Simon hates it, but and I think we have to be really tasteful about how we do this.
I hate pop-ups. I think it's great to put in the help, that kind of clippy. You appear to be using this for an invoice. Have you considered buying professional support? I put in the help. I would advertise the fact that we have a commercial community within the code. But I hate the pop-up that only comes up once and tells you to join the community. Okay. And I would hate even more a pay now, pick one of the following three service providers now button, snooze for one month.
The problem is it's very hard to distinguish Simon as a let's say, consumer user from IBM deploying a million seats in their thing for free and free loading. But in some cases we can. So online already has this concept that if you're using it for more than 10 documents and 20 concurrent users, probably you're a business, not a home or a charity or whatever. And so it then puts up a notice saying, this is not supported in this environment.
So I have a question for you. Yeah. So one of the things you didn't mention anywhere in the presentation was addressable market.
Sure.
And one of my concerns is that because of the way the world is changing and going into cloud-hosted software, the addressable market for the amount of money actually available for collaborative capture is declining on a desktop product. And I wonder whether you have any market research that shows the addressable market and whether you are able to give any indication of the opportunity you believe you have lost by TDF's current behavior.
That is a really good question. I don't know what the addressable market is, but I do know we have 9 million downloads this year. Anecdotally, I meet people repeatedly who think, I've got to deploy LibreOffice, I should deploy LibreOffice. This is one thing when I was 19. And to use an enterprise supported version is somehow unclean or not the right thing to do. And we see large numbers of companies deploying unsupported LibreOffice. We see the UK Cabinet Office, for instance. No support, so they just put LibreOffice on our machines. Until recently, Italian military, 40,000 seats, non-enterprise version of LibreOffice on the seats. And I think small steers can have a huge impact.
But I think my point about them is I wonder whether we went through the phase of enterprises believing that everything needed to be supported, whether we're now reaching a phase where enterprises are not convinced. instance, that they even need a help desk.
Yes.
Because users are self-supporting. And deploying off-the-shelf software, particularly in the user space where the software is not customized, actually there isn't an addressable market there. There's people. It's not that they're not spending the money with you, and it's not that they are harming themselves by not spending money. It's that actually they don't need to spend money, and there's nothing that you can do that is going to make them spend money with anybody.
So it's hard to quantify that. My strong feeling based on our anecdotal and talking to people and trying to sell, and actually positive stories, like so the Italian entrepreneurs is actually a positive story, that they realize that they actually do need some support, but actually the product isn't what they need, and so they do then shift on.
Over 200 phone calls to me
over 2 years,
and me refusing to tell them we will develop that for free.
Right.
Have you considered a premium rate number?
No, I mean, I think it's absolutely fair what they've done, and because it's part of what everyone in the community should do. So if someone calls you independently, that is general, or you say, can you solve that for free? I say no, because if we do that for free for a long time, for a longer period, at the end you will not have anything for free. Not even the product. So you should understand that the product is for free, the basic, but if you want it supported, cannot be for free. Then you can discuss on the cost of support, and that is a different story because you go into commercial. But I can tell you that Generale Sileo has poked me every night after his job at home on my mobile. Can you do that for free? And me telling them, no way. Unfortunately, other people in the community telling that TDF should do that for free, and this was not nice. But I think that probably, and thinking about that over the last few weeks, we probably have approached the entire situation in the right way when we have launched. What we have not done, we have not been thinking regularly on how to update our website. And at the moment, I think that our website, it's not because it's free or it's outdated in terms of supporting the business model.
Yes. And I'm not blaming anyone. I think that's the
business. No. We should have paid more attention to that.
Yes.
But at the moment, we have to pay attention because, for instance, if we want to start serious fundraising, and I showed our website to serious fundraisers, they said, no way. The first image that they see, they should find something for themselves. So I'm a single user, I'm an enterprise, I want to participate, and this should be in the home page.
Yes.
So the home page should divide people according to their interest, and not try to catch anyone.
So I'm very worried that I did it wrong about that from now.
That's unfortunately it was an Indian after you, so we don't have the Indians because of the
visa. I'd really love to get more feedback. Thanks, Todd, for your take.
And tomorrow when I will be talking about fundraising. One of the first things I say is that we cannot start serious fundraising now because we have to change our websites, at least the home page. Content can be the same, but has to be looked down in the tree.
Right.
For instance, even the TDF website should be, I'm a member and not a member.
Right. Yeah.
And I'm a member is the actual website.
Right.
And we should tweak the pages for I'm not a member, because I'm not a member, I want to understand which are the advantages of being a member, which are already in the pages, but you have just to tweak the point of view.
So I completely agree. And I think it's just about having at least half an eye on how the ecosystem, how that flow goes through there. And not, in a way that's vendor neutral, fair, objective, and grows our ecosystem.
No, but I think when you poked me up with your document, I said we should have been more careful in thinking about the website, and probably what we should do in the future is at least once a year have a kind of brainstorming about the website. Is it still good or it has to be improved? Because it's 5 years old or 4 or 5 years old and this is too much.
Yeah, yeah.
For current timings.
And I think actually Simon had a very, very helpful framework. That's a very similar idea. But about when we started LibreOffice, we made a whole load of decisions in this area that made perfect sense at the time. In terms of having giant Sun microsystems coming, Oracle, and also an IBM, trying to, you know, work very hard to make sure that this narrative not in heaven might, you know, be balanced and so on. And I think we're in a different situation now.
Yeah,
by 120 people different.
But so you don't. So we succeeded wildly,
yep.
Because you've got the number you had up there, you know, 1.5 million on your picture. But at the point when the LibreOffice community was created, I don't believe that the market was delivering that much money to development. I think the income that Sun and Oracle had fallen to a level below that.
Really?
And I believe that the amount of money that Red Hat and SUSE were receiving as a consequent from their investment was less than that.
Yeah.
I believe that TEF has created that market by existing and succeeded wildly. And now, 7 years on, what we need protecting from is not people who would stop us creating that market, but people who would diminish that market. And so the way we need to market ourselves is different. We need to be, we need to be encouraging and stimulating the growth of that market and helping people who are aggressive to invest in the product by being part of the community. So I wouldn't say we've failed.
Oh no,
but I would say
the scope has changed.
But I would say we have coasted a bit.
Yes. We can succeed hard.
And probably we should have paid more attention before to that. But of course we were, you know, the fact that OpenOffice still exists gives us a bias anyway, especially the people that were there since day one and know what happened.
Yes.
Because people that came in afterward, when people listen to me talking about OpenOffice and IBM says, they should have done something really wrong, bad to you, as you're speaking this way. And if you're not being involved, of course today you don't understand why.
Well, there was a nasty tweet thread along those lines this week.
So I just be interested in other people's feedback. I mean, there's a lot of people here who have businesses or involved in the ecosystem have ideas, but if anyone else would like to say any questions. Raul, what do you think, Raul? What do you mean? Right? You're happy?
Yeah.
Yeah. Good. I mean, my hint is the volunteers don't feel threatened by a growing ecosystem and that, you know, it's good for everyone. Giving credit to the board.
Sorry, I'll fill the empty space.
No, it's not quite empty yet. We'll do a council meeting while you're open.
So the reason I would talk about the addressable market and whether there's actually any money out there for us to help you get is I believe the market for LibreOffice is in the process of changing.
Yeah.
I believe that LibreOffice is, so OpenOffice and StarOffice, their competitor was Microsoft Office. And always our thinking was in the context of being a competitor with Microsoft Office. I believe Microsoft has basically left the desktop market. They obviously haven't, because they've got nearly a billion people still using it. But if you look at where they are, if you look at where they're heading, Scott nearly always said, skate to where the puck is going, not to where it is. Because he was a nice hockey guy. If you look at where the puck is going to hosted desktops, it's going to online productivity integrated in with other tools. And I wonder whether we need to be asking the question about how we are going to enable our community to address that market as the market we're currently addressing diminishes. And I wonder whether you have any thoughts about how we should be doing that.
Yeah, it's a really good question. And I think one of the problems is, so collaborating with LibreOffice Online, whatever, is not terribly easy to develop for. We see this in Android, the Android space, where the combination of a large C++ code base and Java, and a difficult development environment, all, you know, large C++ code base and JavaScript in the browser, just enlarges the skill base you need. And I think human brains are of a certain finite complexity size. we have very good engineers that have experience on both sides, but even so, I don't feel that comfortable with JavaScript myself. I'm the modern idiot. And I'm sure there are many JavaScript people who also don't feel terribly comfortable in C++, and they're not idiots either. So I think, from a technology perspective, it's quite difficult to find people there. So we've done easy hacks and Google Summer Code things, but it's difficult. So, I don't know, the strategic thing there, I think, would be to reduce the cost or the difficulty of developing on that further.
But I think I'm really talking in marketing terms.
Thank you.
Because so there are some different marketing strategies in that space.
Yeah.
Some vendors are deciding that they will make fair use of the LibreOffice brand. Mm. Collabor has decided to create a separate brand.
Sure.
And so then my real question is, what is the right way for us to help the emerging addressable market to find our community members?
Yeah.
In that new reality. And I think that's really the question I'd like answered. I suspect you don't want to answer that question.
No, I'm very happy to answer it. So again, I think that marketing is very, very powerful in terms of bringing leads and attention to people. And I think that attention needs to be in some way related to investment. So providing big links to them, they're a fine company, but they haven't contributed much. So I think we need to carefully balance, in a factual and meaningful way, etc., the presentation of those things. But I think having a LibreOffice online page that points out the main, participants in tasteful ways is helpful. And we should do that. I think we've got one already, some links on to those people.
And we're not, we are, in this TVF and LibreOffice, we're not even providing LibreOffice online, we're not hosting it, so maybe that makes it a bit simpler to say, you've got to go to somebody else, and if you want it, you can't just get the quick, cheap version from us and pretend there's no, or forget that there's commercial support. If it is LibreOffice online, because we're not going to host it, you have to go to the company.
So it's useful, just to say, easily we provide source, I think, releases instead of releases. We do provide Docker images or LibreOffice online, so you can download those, and we should publicize them all on that page. I think if the market moves this way, it will be, we can get the investment thing right, there will be more interest. I don't see signs of that already. I think LibreOffice online, for all of my sales pitches, is still relatively, it needs to improve. I mean, I see the problems. And as we improve it, and as we have invested that last year, we've seen increased interest in it. So, I'm confident that as soon as there is, money to be seen, everybody will be coming in and interested. So I'm really optimistic about the future, though, which is why we do so much to invest in that system. For Simon's reasons, strategic marketing partner.
Yeah. Yeah, I was asking from a system integrator point of view.
Sure.
Since over time, if you've been any kind of system integrator, you have consultants, you sell products. Mm-hmm. Of course, you would sell the marketing products. You wouldn't. Because you couldn't even sell them in LibreOffice. So you would have an uphill battle to just say, here's something different. Mm. People usually don't want different, they want the same as everyone else. And they earn a lot of money by doing almost nothing. So that saves guys like that. LibreOffice Online is, for me, as I've been discussing with several of you, I see that the big game changer where the system integrators are facing Microsoft eating their big lunch by taking into Office 365 and billing the customer directly. There's much less to do as a system integrator because you convert people, you can move their Active Directory stuff, you can move their inboxes and so forth. After that, how much money is it for the system integrators?
There's no future.
A lot less. Yeah, it's a bleak future for them. But going forward with LibreOffice Online, If that's a viable combined like Nextcloud on cloud stuff or whatever, they could create a service that they can sell, that they can market themselves, and they can create their own revenue and say it like SSC companies are doing already with these kind of products. Say that here's a solution that is similar to Office 365, but you're using it and it's fully open and it's cheaper and it's better, and the margin stays at the system integrator. that it is a big game changer, because I agree with Michael that sort of LibreOffice or Microsoft Office as a on-prem solution is a market focus, it's a kind of way of using if you think about things.
I want to just give you this question if you can as well. Thank you, Ben. I think all those are really good points, and we try to reach this one. Yeah. There are a lot of good ideas, but I've not yet found the magic for those sales. Uwe.
There's one really key drawback of this idea in the The drawback is we get to listen as project.
Sorry, say again, we are...
We will go invisible. We,
okay.
Here.
Yeah,
because this is very surprising. The integrator will not mention it. I will show you one of the...
You're right.
The biggest internet provider in Europe, United States.
Yeah.
It's just start the data phase of LibreOffice online in all three.
Yes, and they probably contribute nothing at all.
And nothing left. Okay, we gave back the double image words.
So, I think Linux runs on your Android phone. It's called Android. Linux runs on your supercomputer. It's called Cluster for NASA or something like that. But at the end of the day, these people do bring something back. But I think you're right. We just need to encourage people to contribute. And I think this also brings these joys. So we can at least try and steer people the right way.
Okay. Yeah.
Awesome. Look at that. So that's a good sign in itself in terms of coming and contributing back. We love you. Come and contribute. So, anyway, thank you for your time. You've been wonderful.